Good morning, Holy Trinity. Welcome. Our opening song is number 665 on the Grace Songbook, Hosea. Please stand as we all sing.
Good morning, everyone. I'm so glad that you chose to make the effort to come. Obviously, not everybody can, so let's keep in mind and heart or in our prayers those who may be stuck up in the hills for whatever reason, and I just ask God to help bless them as they may be watching online today. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit,
amen.
The Lord be with you.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, as we come together today, we have a special tradition for Lent, and Deacon Brett, you'll explain.
Yeah, we've entered the season of Lent, obviously, so as is our custom here, we'll begin in kind of a penitential spirit by kneeling and praying the Confiteor together. So if you don't have that memorized, it's on page 4 in your gray missals. Please kneel. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen.
Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy. Let us stand and let us pray. Grant Almighty God, through the yearly observances of Holy Lent, that we may grow in understanding of the riches hidden in Christ, and by worthy conduct pursue their effects. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis. The Lord God formed man out of the clay of the ground and blew into his nostrils the breath of life. And so man became a living being. Then the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east and placed there the man whom he had formed. Out of the ground, the Lord God made various trees grow that were delightful to look at and good for food. with the tree of life in the middle of the garden and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now the serpent was the most cunning of all animals that the Lord God had made. The serpent asked the woman, "Did God really tell you not to eat from any of the trees in the garden?" The woman answered the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden. It is only about the fruit of the tree in the middle of the garden that God said, 'You shall not eat it or even touch it, lest you die.'" But the serpent said to the woman, "You certainly will not die. No, God knows well that the moment you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like gods, who know what is good and what is evil." The woman saw that the tree was good for food, pleasing to the eyes, and desirable for gaining wisdom. So she took some of its fruit and ate it. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized that they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. The word of the Lord. Responsorial Psalm. Be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned.
Be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned.
Have mercy on me, O God, in your goodness, in the greatness of your compassion, wipe out my offense. Thoroughly wash me from my guilt. Response: Be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned. For I acknowledge my offense, and my sin is before me always. Against you only have I sinned, done what is evil in your sight. Response: Be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned. A clean heart create for me, O Lord, and a steadfast spirit renew within me. Cast me not out from your presence, and your Holy Spirit take not from me. Response:
Merciful, O Lord.
Give me back the joy of your salvation, and a willing spirit sustain in me. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall proclaim your praise. Response:
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, through one man sin entered the world, and through sin death. And thus death came to all men, inasmuch as all sinned. For if by the transgression of the one death came to reign through that one, how much more will those who received the abundance of grace and of the gift of justification come to reign in life through the one Jesus Christ? In conclusion, just as through one transgression condemnation came upon all, so through one righteous act acquittal and life came to all. For just as through the disobedience of the one man the many were made sinners, so through the obedience of the one the many will be made righteous. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And with
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you.
At that time, Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. He fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was hungry. The tempter approached and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." He said in reply, "It is written, 'One does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes forth from the mouth of God.'" Then the devil took him to the holy city and made him stand on the parapet of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, 'He will command his angels concerning you, and with their hands they will support you, lest you dash your foot against a stone.'" Jesus answered him, "Again, it is written, 'You shall not put the Lord your God to the test.'" Then the devil took him up to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in their magnificence. And he said to him, "All these I shall give you if you will prostrate yourself and worship me." At this, Jesus said to him, "Get away, Satan. It is written, 'The Lord your God shall you worship, and him alone shall you serve.'" Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered to him. The Gospel of the Lord. Good morning, everybody. Thanks for braving the weather this morning. It's good to have you all here. We were a little lonely this morning at the 8, so glad you're here. I don't know if you've ever found yourself in a situation, maybe it was around the dinner table or on a date or maybe even in a meeting where you were trying to say something. Maybe you were even trying to say something important, only to find that the person across from you was more interested in their cell phone or the game on TV, or, I don't know, their own preoccupations, whatever those might be. Have you ever been in that situation? In my house, I'll tell you what the problem is. The problem is inside the NBA, right? Don't even try and start a conversation when Charles and Shaq and Ernie and Kenny are on because you don't stand a chance, right? There's so much that vies for our attention, you guys. So much noise. It's hard to listen to one another, isn't it? And I think it's hard, too, to listen to God. Maybe even more so for God, because God doesn't have to just compete against our externals, if you will, right? So our technology and our entertainment and our busy schedules. God has to compete against the internals as well. So those voices inside our hearts, right, that are always clamoring for our attention. So the voices of our fears and our hurts and our worries and our resentments. And maybe that's why when we go to prayer, so often we end up just navel-gazing, right? I mean, we go in intending to pray, but then we end up forgetting about God. And we spend the whole time listening to those inner voices, forgetting to listen for the voice of God. And then we also wonder why we miss God's peace in our life. You know, I think our first reading is a really good illustration of this. Most of us have heard this story of the fall again and again, so much so that we really don't even notice the details anymore. But if we pay attention to them, I think we'll see that this story is really our story as well. So bear with me. Let's take a look at this story just for a couple minutes together. So the story, it really takes off when Eve encounters the serpent, right? Now the serpent, we're told, is the most cunning of God's creatures. And it certainly seems to be the case, right? Because he plays Eve really well, doesn't he? Notice his first question. He says, "Did God really say not to eat from any of the trees in the garden?" And you know, on the face of it, we might say, well, that's a silly question. Of course God wouldn't say something like that. We know that. Eve knows that. But notice what the question does, right? It kind of induces Eve, or it tricks her into revealing a vulnerability, a chink in her armor. Listen to her response. She says, "We may eat of the trees in the garden. It's only from the tree in the middle of the garden that God says you shall not eat it or even touch it, lest you die." Is that what God said? No, God didn't say, God said, "Don't eat from the tree." He did say that, right? But he didn't say, "Don't touch it." He said nothing about touching it. So Eve has taken God's words here, and she's added to them.
Why is that? Why is that? Well, I don't know for sure, but could it be that God's words, God's assurances to her and Adam, maybe even God's plans for her, weren't enough? Did she feel like she needed to hedge her bets, perhaps? To have a plan B, just in case? One she could control? Was there some kind of an insecurity going on in her heart about her relationship with God? The serpent seems to think so, because notice he hones right in on that, doesn't he? This question of trust, he goes right there with his next words, and he drives a wedge right between Eve and God. He says, you won't die. Just the opposite, in fact. You'll become like gods. God knows this. Heck, maybe God's afraid of that. Why else would he hold out on you? Are you sure you can trust him? Does he really have your back? And friends, as we know, it's here that things start to fall apart, right? Because doubts, fears, insecurities, that's all part of our life in this mortal world, isn't it? And if Eve had taken those and gone to God with those, who knows how the story might have turned out? But unfortunately, by this point, God's out of the picture, right? God's not even on Eve's radar. All she can hear is the voice of the serpent echoing the fears in her own heart. All she can see in front of her is a solution to her problems on her terms. And so she stretches out her hand, she takes, and she eats. Well, as I said, this is really our story, isn't it? I don't know what your personal demons are, my friends, but we're all children of Eve. And like Eve, we all have those voices inside and maybe even outside that compete with God for our attention. I mean, we want to listen to God, but maybe more often we end up listening to the crowd or to our social media or to our own security or resentment or pride or lust, our own craving for approval. Whatever it might be. Guys, Lent is a time to retune the ears of our heart, to turn our gaze back to God, to hear him say once more to each of us, you are my beloved child. I know your heart. I know what's best for you, and I have plans for you. So come back to me. Come back to me. We could stumble. In fact, it'd be really easy, wouldn't it, to just go through these next six weeks and come to Easter and find that not much has changed in our life. Or we can make this a time where we open ourselves to God's grace, open ourselves to his healing touch, allow him to reach down inside and become present to those dark places within. Return to the Lord, you guys. Return to the Lord. You don't have to have your act together. You don't need to hide anything. You don't need to pretend that your life is something that it's not. Come as you are, warts and all. Give God your attention once more. Give him your heart once more. That's really what the point is of our fasting and our prayer and our sacrifices during this season. They're not self-improvement projects. They're not tests of our willpower. They're invitations to refocus our gaze, to retune the ears of our heart, to weaken that ego inside with its incessant demands, right? To listen once more. So I would challenge you to find one thing this Lent, whatever it is. Spend time before the Blessed Sacrament. Read God's word. Go for walks. Serve God by serving your neighbor. Pray the rosary, the stations, the surrender novena. Dare to fast, dare to be hungry, and allow that hunger to put you in touch with your hunger for God. Whatever you do, let God have your attention once more, even if it's only for 10 minutes, and you might be surprised at what God can say to you, even in just 10 minutes, if you're paying attention. I think it was Mother Teresa who once said, "We need to find God, but he cannot be found in noise and restlessness. God is the friend of silence." Well, friends, we need silence today, exterior and interior. Silence if we are to return to God. Silence if we're to hear his voice. Silence if we are to learn to touch the hearts of others.
I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men, for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Now let us place before our compassionate God our needs and those of the whole world.
For the grace to draw closer to God this Lent and to find peace, healing, and purpose in his presence, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our RCIA candidates and catechumens as they begin this final period of preparation for Easter sacraments, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our monastics and religious and all who devote their life to praying for the church and for the world, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those struggling with oppressive temptation in their lives, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the dying and for all of our beloved dead, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our private intentions, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. God of the deserts and high places, see into our hearts. Grant our prayers, spoken and silent, which we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Give us the right dispositions, O Lord, we pray, to make these offerings, for with them we celebrate the beginning of this venerable time, this venerable and sacred time, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. By abstaining 40 long days from earthly food, he consecrated through his fast the pattern of our Lenten observance. And by overturning all the snares of the ancient serpent, taught us to cast out the leaven of malice, so that celebrating worthily the Paschal mystery, we might pass over at last to the eternal Paschal feast. And so, with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise as without end we acclaim. As we know, are in Lent, and we in Lent have a penitential sense of the season. We'll be offering the Eucharistic prayers for Masses of Reconciliation today, number one, if you're following in a missal. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and from the world's beginning are ceaselessly at work, so that the human race may become holy, just as you yourself are holy. Look, we pray, upon your people's offerings, and pour out on them the power of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, in whom we too are your sons and daughters. Indeed, though we once were lost and could not approach you, you loved us with the greatest love. For your Son, who alone is just, handed himself over to death and did not disdain to be nailed for our sake to the wood of the cross. But before his arms were outstretched between heaven and earth to become the lasting sign of your covenant, he desired to celebrate the Passover with his disciples. As he ate with them, he took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to them, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, knowing that he was about to reconcile all things to himself through his blood to be shed on the cross, he took the chalice filled with the fruit of the vine. And once more, giving you thanks, he handed the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of your Son, Jesus Christ, who is our Passover and our surest peace, we celebrate his death and resurrection from the dead. And looking forward to his blessed coming, we offer you, who are our faithful and merciful God, this sacrificial victim who reconciles to you the human race. Look kindly, most compassionate Father, on those you unite to yourself by the sacrifice of your Son, and grant that, by the power of the Holy Spirit, as they partake of this one bread and one chalice, they may be gathered into one body in Christ, who heals every division. Be pleased to keep us in communion of mind and heart, together with Francis, our Pope, and Alexander, our Bishop, Peter's assistant bishop, and help us to work together for the coming of your kingdom until the hour when we stand before you, saints among the saints in the halls of heaven, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles and all the saints, and with our deceased brothers and sisters, whom we humbly commend to your mercy. Then freed at last from the wound of corruption and made fully into a new creation, we shall sing to you with gladness the thanksgiving of Christ, who lives for all eternity. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let's offer each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Renewed now with heavenly bread, by which faith is nourished, hope increased, and charity strengthened, we pray, O Lord, that we may learn to hunger for Christ, the true and living bread, and strive to live by every word that proceeds from your mouth. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hello, Nick.
Hey, Father Bill.
How are you doing?
I'm doing well.
Excellent.
Good morning, everybody. Thanks for joining us again at Holy Trinity. First, unfortunately, the bulletins did not make it here this week. They got lost in the snow.
Oh,
so,
no.
Yeah.
Sorry. What are we going to do?
They're all digital online as well. So if you are if you'd like to see a bulletin, you can find one online. Or we might have a few copies here next week as well. One of the important announcements for the week, though, is that we are looking for a dedicated master gardener to help all of our other volunteers with our new garden that is now up at the food closet. So if you love to garden and you can help coordinate planting schedules and care schedules, then please email Michelle over at the food closet. And her email can be found in the bulletin, which we don't have, or online on the website.
Right, bulletin, yes. That again.
Where she's right back there.
Yes. So the garden guru is who we're looking for there.
Yeah.
Just a reminder on our Lenten ministries, we have soup suppers every Friday at 6 p.m., followed by Stations of the Cross at 7 p.m. here in the church. And we have our communal reconciliation service coming up in 2 weeks on March 11th at 10 a.m. So that's a great friendly way to come receive confession. And I think we're going to have like 10 priests here this time around.
Nine. So we had six last time. We had 400 people coming, which is amazing. I've never seen that myself. But then everything is new since I've been here. I'm sure that's the norm. I hope. That's awesome. But expecting more anyway in Lent, typically where I've been, it's always been more in Lent. And so we're preparing for that with nine priests. So that'll help your waiting in lines to be shorter.
So that's the communal reconciliation service, March 11th at 10 a.m. Last piece of not so good news, coffee and donuts also did not make it this week. I'm sorry.
You know, Father Hans likes broccoli. We should get like a broccoli cart and then just put it out there. Warm water. You can tell Father Hans I said that. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit. Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing.
May bountiful blessings, O Lord, we pray, come down upon your people, that hope may grow in tribulation, virtue be strengthened in temptation, and eternal redemption be assured. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Mass is ended. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.